Over the last 50 years, American gays have gone from a clandestine clique of queens and butchies to a rich, mini-hued quilt of types and subtypes, all of whom may now legally wed.
Slang holds an important place in gay culture. Prior to the legalization of gay marriage and gay sex acts, it was often necessary for gay people to speak in a coded language simply in order to meet one another without tipping off the authorities. Gays of Britain even had their own form of sub-language called Polari, which kind of sounded like pidgin Italian and was basically the lingua franca for guys who wanted to sleep with guys or girls who wanted to sleep with girls. While today's gays are free to speak openly about what kind of guys they like to fuck, many still relish the secret speech of their progenitors, bears especially.
Before they had their own flags with the subtypes, bears were a fringe stripe of the gay subcultural rainbow. Too hairy for the Chelsea Boy Queen scene, too hefty for the Tom of Finland-esque Castro clones, bears quietly consorted with one another through early internet Usenet groups and mailing lists and the back pages of Bear Magazine, before finally bursting into the gay overground with the first international bear rendezvous in 1995. Today, there are rendezvous-style events like Bear Week all year long and across the country, and bears make up, at least in terms of mass, the largest distinct body of gay men in America.
The term bear once referred to a very specific type of gay man, a particularly big and hairy gay man. Over time, bears have evolved into an entire family of gay men of various body types and hairinesses.
Everyone thinks of bears as being big, fat, overweight, you know, beefy guys. But there are a lot of guys that are in really good shape.
I heard muscle bear. Is that a derogatory term? Or?
No. That's probably more what we identify with.
You guys are like classic strong men. And a cub's just a...
Cub's like a young, hairy guy.
Usually a young, hairy guy.
Yeah.
There are cubs, which are basically just young bears or bears in training. There are pocket bears, which are different from cubs in that they are not necessarily young, but small, like the type of bear you would put in your pocket.
Furry and in shape's an otter.
Yeah.
Okay, furry and in shape's an otter.
That's an otter.
Otters are skinny guys who are still hairy, still beloved by the bear community.
Silver-haired.
Polar bears.
Polar bear.
Some of the Asian guys call themselves pandas.
There are polar bears who are older bears with white hair, or fur, if you will. Panda bears are Asian bears. Black bears are black bears.
Are you a bear?
I would be considered a pup.
Pup, okay.
Well, like, and I have a master, like my boyfriend.
So. Oh, okay, that's the lock. I see.
One of the newest iterations of bears is pups and wolves. This isn't so much like a reference to people's body types. To be a pup is more to be kind of like a submissive in a certain kind of relationship with a kind of master-servant power dynamic. You see pups will wear butt plug tails and little leather dog masks and chains often, and the chain is controlled or locked by their master. Sometimes that master is a wolf, although I've been confused as to the exact meaning of it, because sometimes wolf refers to somebody who just is a lone wolf and fucks a lot of dudes.
Beardom's been growing. Like, at least
leaps and bounds. It's an industry now.
The
thing I love so much about gay life in general is that we are not as exclusionary as the rest of the world in terms of what we expect in a sexual partner. I know many women who don't want a man if he's shorter than she is.
Oh, of course.
And gay men have learned to eroticize almost everything.
In conclusions, the bear community is one of many contrasts.